With Jesus in my boat, I can smile through the storm, smile through the storm, smile through the storm. With Jesus in my boat, I can smile through the storm as we go sailing on. You guys not know this song? Do you not know that song? Who knows that song? My family. I'm the only one here that went to campus, but I'm going to have to get on these slacking... No, come on. There's you. Come here. Come here. Don't raise your hand when I ask a question. I know you know the song. Did you sing that song? No? What? What?
Yeah.
Oh, you did? Okay, you can go sit back down now. I've embarrassed you enough. It's a song we sang this past week at camp. It's a song that I've sung for many years at camp. And this past week I was at camp, so swatting. This was the basic motion of the at camp. We swatted a lot of mosquitoes at camp, but that song came up and it just seems to be appropriate, right? Yesterday we had a boat renaming party, and it seems appropriate that today we have Jesus asleep on the back of the boat, and if Jesus is in our boat, we can smile through the storm, right? We're all just happy all the time and know that everything's going to be great. Maybe, maybe not. But Jesus is in our boat, so why do we have to worry? Why should we worry? Well, if any of you read my blog, you know that I questioned, what about those other boats? Because it said that the disciples took him just as he was into their boat, and they went, and there were other boats with them. There's no mention of these other boats at the end. There's no mention of anything happening. All we know is that the disciples, in their fear and trepidation, woke up Jesus on the back of the boat, asked him if he cared about whether or not they lived or died, and then he stood up and said, calm everything. And the disciples got more anxious, not more calm. But the question that really arises is, why did the disciples cross the lake? So you're all worried, right? Why? Why did the chicken go halfway across the road? Because they wanted to lay it on the line. All right, back to the sermon. Why did the disciples cross the lake? To get to the other side, right? That's why the chicken crossed the road, to get to the other side. The disciples didn't cross the lake to get to the other side. The disciples crossed the lake because Jesus told them to. Because how many of us would actually go across the lake? Well, that's the wrong question to ask of this crowd. How many of us would actually go across the lake if we didn't have to? Yes, I know. A bunch of you are going to raise your hands because it's fun to be out there on it. But that's not the point. The point of the story is, where did they go? Where did the disciples go when they got in that little boat and went across that little lake? It doesn't really tell us, does it? Next week we'll find out. Next week we'll hear chapter 5, Mark chapter 5, and we'll hear that they went to the Greek side of the lake. They're all Jews, but they went across the lake to where people were different than them. Because that's what Jesus tells us to do, right? In the Gospel of Matthew, he tells us to go into all the world, making disciples of all nations. This is Mark's great mission. Jesus telling the disciples to get into the boat, to go across the lake, to take the message of what he's been telling them to somebody that's different than them. And how many of us have to go very far to find somebody different than us? How far do you have to go to find somebody different than you? Not that far at all anymore, right? We no longer live in communities where we're all the same. We no longer live in places where everybody is just like us. Different people come to us, but do they come all the time? What is this message today supposed to tell us? When Jesus is in our boat, we can smile at what's happening around us.
because we're going to continually fail to be failing on. The next question that this gospel passage brings up is, where are you all sitting? And this is a trick question. Where are you all sitting?
Well, you're not actually sitting in a church because the church, you are the church. You can't be sitting in yourself. You're sitting in a church building. We've had this conversation with council a lot about what do we call this place? This is not the church. We are the church. So you're not sitting in church. Where are you sitting? What is this room called? A sanctuary. What is another name for this part of the sanctuary?
Nave.
What does the word nave mean? Naval. Navy. Naval comes from that. It comes from the root word navus. See? You're sitting in the nave of the church. You're sitting in the of the church. Have you ever noticed that when you go into a, this one even kind of looks like it, not quite as much as some of our older congregations. You go into an older church building and it's got the arched ceiling and the nice wood planks and you look at the beams going up and what does it look like? It looks like an upside down boat. That's not an accident. It's not an accident at all. Because what is a boat? Another trick question. What is a boat? It's a vessel. And what does it do? It transports people different places. It's kind of like a car. Right? You get in a car to go places on land. You get in a boat to go places on the water. It's a mode of transportation. Sometimes a boat is just a boat. We want to look at this passage and say, oh, that boat represents our lives and how Jesus is always in our lives and everything is going to be great and good. No, it's a boat. There's nothing else to it. The disciples were made to get into the boat to go across the sea because he was making them to no longer be just listeners and learners of his teaching, but he was helping them to see that the mission was not just to listen to him and learn and to be safe in our own environment, but that we had to take that message out and across the sea to places that we didn't want to go, to people that aren't like us. We have to take that message out to the world and not stay safe in our little boat. It's about going out and telling other people. I had a real struggle this week not being at camp. Camp was wonderful, except for the mosquitoes. I had a struggle this week with everything that happened, right? I made a comment this morning about how, you know, as much as all of you know how big of a fan of social media I am, I really wish we didn't have it this past week. So I couldn't hear all the stuff that's happening all over the world. That's terrible. Right? Wednesday night in Charleston, South Carolina, 9 people killed in the church that started the AME denomination, the Mother AME Church. 9 people gunned down. On Thursday morning in the news, the church where Jesus fed the 5,000 was burned in an arson. It wasn't an accident. Church is destroyed. Anything in it that was wood is gone. And all of the stone that the walls were made out of is burnt so bad that they're probably not going to be able to clean it to reuse it. On Friday, a police officer was shot and killed in Cincinnati, Ohio. What do we do about all of these things when we hear about them? How do we deal with the things in the world that make us fear and trepidation and want to stay in our houses so that nothing bad happens to us? Right? It's about those things that aren't associated with us. But here's the thing that I've already mentioned to several of you. We're very closely connected to what happened in South Carolina as the ELCA. Because those 2 pastors out of the 9 people that were killed in that church that night graduated from Lutheran Southern Seminary. One of our ELCA seminaries. And the shooter is a member of an ELCA congregation. How do we deal with that? Those of you that went to Synod Assembly or to the concert before Synod Assembly at St. Jonathan Marion saw Agape. I saw a message this past week from Agape, David Shear, who's a Lutheran rapper, about how he was on Thursday in South Carolina with a gathering of youth and pastors from that synod. He was there with classmates of the two men that were shot, and there with the pastor of the congregation that the gunman came from. If Jesus is in our boat, we can smile through what's happening. How does that happen? How does that work? Just because Jesus is in our boat, does that make everything perfect? Does that make everything right? No, it doesn't. But what we can't do is cower in fear and stay where we think we need to stay so that we don't get hurt. We can't stay locked up in our houses. We can't stay locked up in ourselves so that we don't see anything else around us happening in the world, because you know what God told us we had to do? Get in the boat and go across the lake. You can't stay locked in your comfort zone. You can't stay the same way that you are, because I need you to go into the world to tell them how much I love you and how much I love them. And that love's not going to change things overnight, because we've got lots of things that we have to deal with. But if we can listen and trust that no matter where we go or what we do, that God is always going to be with us, then yes, we can smile because of knowing that Christ goes with us everywhere we go. And I was told out there before service that I had to bring you up, and you're all sitting there like this right now. Like, oh my God. So to bring you up a little bit, this song that I sang at the beginning of my sermon, right, with Jesus in my boat, I can smile through the storm. As we did it at Camp Luther, I know they did it at Imago Dei Village too. You take out words, right? It's with Jesus in my boat, I can smile through the storm, smile through the storm, smile through the storm. With Jesus in my boat, I can smile through the storm as we go sailing on. But then the next part is you take out smile, right? So with Jesus in my boat, I can smile through the storm. Oh, I'm sorry. I'm making sure you're paying attention. Well, do you want to come to it? With Jesus in my boat, I can whoop through the storm, whoop through the storm, whoop through the storm. With Jesus in my boat, I can whoop through the storm. As we get to bed, and then you take out the storm, right? With Jesus in my boat, I can whoop through the... What's the... With... Perfect, and it's not going to be without problems, but we are able to whoop through the because Jesus is there sending us out and telling us to go. So no matter where He sends you, go in fear, in trepidation, but go in the fear that knowing that God is with you. Because just like those disciples in the boat, sometimes it's scary to come face to face with God when we actually hear Him and know that He's calling and sending us to go someplace. But that's a good fear, because Jesus is always going to be there. That's what we have to remember. And that's where we have to go. As His disciples, we have to take the risk, to take the step, to get into the boat and go on the journey that He's calling us to go on. Because we are the ones that can show His love to the world that needs to so desperately see it.